This is Coding Math, Application 4, Ballistics, Part 4. In this episode, we're going to wrap up the core mechanics of this game by adding a target and some collision detection. If you have any questions on collision detection, I suggest you check out Episode 14, which covers the basics of that. Now, what type of collision detection you use depends, of course, on the types of objects you're detecting. In Episode 14, we covered circle-to-circle, rectangle-to-rectangle, point-to-circle, and point-to-rectangle collisions. This doesn't cover all the bases by far, but you can usually get pretty close with one or more of these techniques. For example, say I wanted to check for the collision of two race cars as seen top-down, like this. Well, these aren't exactly rectangles, but they can be approximated by rectangles. Or say I had a Saturn-like planet here, and a UFO-looking spaceship here. Neither one of these is a perfect circle, but you might be able to get away with doing circle-circle collision detection here. Anytime you have a very small object, like a bullet, you can usually get by using one of the point collision detection methods. To keep things simple here, I'm going to make the target a circle. Then we can use the circle collision function we created in the collision detection episode to check for a hit. Of course, this is only possible with the updated particle.js file we created in episode 17. So I've moved that updated file into this project. This also means that we'll have a bit of cleanup to do to get this working, since the particle API is a little different now. So we'll go into our main JS file. This should be just how we left it last week. First, we'll update it to work with the new particle object. A big part of this is changing the position get x and y calls to simply use x and y. There's only a few, but I'll use a search and replace to do that. Now in the shoot function, there are a few position and velocity set calls. For position, these are just setting x and y, so we can change those to set the x and y of the cannonball directly. For the velocity, we'll have to do this manually for now. The basic force we'll be adding is the number we get by calling utils map. So let's move that into its own variable called force. Then we can set vx and vy using the cosine and sine of the gun angle times that force. Later, we'll add set heading and set speed functions to the particle, so this kind of thing will be a little easier. And that should pretty much take care of the cleanup. So we can move on to the target. We'll add a target variable up at the top here, and we'll make it a generic object. Then, just before we start updating, we'll call a function named setTarget. And now we need to create this function. This function will set the x and y and radius properties of this target object. For x, we'll use the random range function we created in mini number 6 to set it somewhere between 200 and the width of the canvas. This just ensures that it's somewhere to the right of the gun. The y value will just be the height of the canvas, and radius will also use random range to set the radius to something between 10 and 40. Now that we've randomly placed the target, we can move on to the actual collision detection. We need to check for a collision each time the cannonball moves, so right after we call cannonball update. We'll just call a function named checkTarget. And then we'll create that function. Since the particle now has direct x, y, and radius properties, we can use the circleCollision function from the utils library. We just pass in the cannonball and target to that function, and that's going to return true if those two objects are colliding. So what do we do if there is a collision? We create an amazing explosion effect. And when I say we this time, I mean you. You might want to see if you can use the fireworks we created in episode 12 for this, or something similar. Maybe I'll do that in a future episode. Now this is also where you might want to update the user's score, play a sound effect, etc., anything that would happen when a collision occurs. At any rate, we've now hit the target, so we've won the game. Or at least we've won this round. For the next round, we call setTarget again, which will randomly place the target to a new position and give it a new random radius. The only thing left is to draw the target. We do that down here at the bottom of the draw function. We'll set the fill style to red and draw a circle using target x, y, and radius. And now the moment of truth. We aim the gun, We carefully wait for the power meter to hit just the right point, and we hit the space bar. And collision! First try. Ah, the wonders of video editing. Let's see if I can do it again. Yeah, not so much. Okay, so I've discovered that there's two main strategies here. One is to try to get a consistent power level on each shot by timing it so that it's always at the top of the meter, for example, and then just adjusting the gun angle. The other method is to leave the gun alone and try to time the power so your shots just reach the target. Of course, you can try dealing with both of these at the same time, but that gets pretty chaotic. Anyway, there you go, the mechanics of a simple shooting game. You need some better graphics, some scoring, maybe some kind of logic that starts with larger, easier to hit targets and moves on to smaller, harder ones. But that's all stuff that's going to make your game unique. You could wind up with two very different games, each based off the same mechanics that are here at this point. I'd love to see what you come up with. Send me a link and I'll share it in future videos. See you next week.